Shall we please rise up to pray? The Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we come before you because of the mighty God. We pray that as we listen to your words today, Lord, we'll become better Christians. We'll become better husbands. We'll become better wives. We'll become better children. We'll become better citizens. We'll become better leaders. We'll become better learners. We pray that your word will touch us today. We pray, Lord, you give us insight into your word. We pray, O Lord, that your hand of your power will visit us, will transform us, will translate us into your pleasing in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, because I know that you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen, amen, and amen. Welcome, everybody. It's a great delight to physically lead us to study 83 in the systematic study of Ephesians, learning and leaning on the leader's life, part 22. Before we go any further on this week's topic, last week, the Holy Spirit was gracious in the flight that transcended at three major airports. Airport number one, Christ leadership role for the Christly Superman. Airport number two, church learning right for the Christly Superwoman. Airport number three, congenial law abiding recline for the Christly Supernatural. At airport number one, Christ leadership role for the Christly Superman, we'll consider the Ephesians 5 verse 22a, therefore. We understood from that same verse, we will compare that same verse to Ephesians 5 verse 23, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, for he is the savior of the body. And we'll consider how is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ the head and savior of the body. We'll look at that, number one, that he is the assertiveness of the church. Number two, the authority of the church. Number three, the appreciation of the church. Number four, the attraction of the church. Number five, the authenticity of the church. Number six, the height of the church. Number seven, the heaven sent of the church. Number eight, the higher flower of the church. Number nine, the movement of the church. Number 10, the meaning of the church. Number 11, the motivator of the church. The mediator of the church. Number 13, the message of the church. Number 14, the respect of the church. Number 15, the reason for the church. Number 16, the resourcefulness of the church. Number 17, the recognition of the church. Number 18, the reassurance of the church. Number 19, the righteousness of the church. And number 20, the rewarder of the church. We went up further. The Holy Spirit took us further to explicate the leadership role of a Christly Superman in a home. That a Christly Superman is a born-again masculine soul who has surrendered his life to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That he is the husband of a wife, not wives, because our Lord Jesus Christ is not the head of churches, but the head of the church. The church is the physical and spiritual summation of all saved souls across the earth. That this is not a dimensional sphere, nor a non-dimensional congregation of those who are washed by the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We looked at submission in the family setting number three, that we should understand that the husband, who is a Christly Superman, in an ideal home to his wife, is likened to Christ and the church. That he should function as number one, he should function in the announcement of his wife to neighbors, friends and family by his good conduct. Number two, assigning doable responsibility to his wife for the good of the home and society. Number three, allotting an encouraging measure of respect to his wife within the confines of his home and society. Number four, protection of his wife physically and spiritually and her cherished godly interests. Number five, provision of his wife's needs with mutuality. Number six, projection of his wife's aspirations amid oppositions and robust times. Number seven, structural formation of a mindset along Christ's true life's impact, rational decision to meet the demands of heaven. Number eight, satisfaction of emotional needs with his wife's fair understanding of fluctuating body chemistry and mood swing. Number nine, satisfaction of spiritual needs with his lead to present our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to her. Number 10, sustainability of his wife's gifts or qualities to achieving a greater force in the home and society. Number 11, celebrity of his wife's by easing tax in order to manage a breakdown health-wise. Number 12, enrichment of his wife's loyalty to the Almighty God by providing critical advice and push when required. Number 13, extolling his wife's emotional and physical contributions to the home for greater performance. Number 14, defense of his wife before all, publicly, and correcting her privately when necessary. Number 15, distinction of his wife from others as he practically avoids undue comparisons with other women. Number 16, doting on her as required to lubricate the union. Number 17, fulfill the mandate of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for his home as he carries his wife along the path of meeting the objective. Number 18, forward thinking for the home through collaborative effort with his wife. Number 19, forward looking on the wife's acceleration in life with our knowledge of his expectation. Number 20, fruition of his wife's efforts by rewarding her in various acceptable ways. In continuing last week, the Holy Spirit transcended at airport number 2, the church lane ride for the Christly superwoman. In Ephesians 5 verse 2 is 4b, as the church is subject unto Christ. As the church is subject unto Christ. We look at submission in the following setting, part 4. Who is the Christly superwoman? What's her role in the family? We're told that the Christly superwoman is a born-again feminine soul who has given her life to the Almighty God through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. She possesses the Spirit of God and sincerely follows the footsteps of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. She's transformed and demonstrates Christ-likeness. We're told, number 1, she recognizes her husband's presence wherever she is. Number 2, respects her husband's demands even though he's not with her. Number 3, realign her dreams to accommodate her husband's expectations. Number 4, reorganize her itinerary to protect her husband's interests. Number 5, retouch her joint decision with her husband by practically towing the required steps. Number 6, relay her moves and experiences to her husband in line with God's expectations. Number 7, return the fruits of submission to her home for her children to learn respectfulness. Number 8, reactivate her obedience to the Almighty God by being submissive to her husband in decision making. Number 9, responsive to her husband adequately and not the hypocritical response to other men outside her home when she exchanges pleasantries. Number 10, rehearses the scriptures before her children and husband, setting the spirit high for the day's challenges. Number 11, thankful to her husband even though she happens to be the breadwinner at the time. Number 12, translate tranquility into her home to desirable serenity for heaven's attention. Number 13, toughen herself in her comportment not to sell her daughters out to the society, dressing half naked or unclad to impress the right attitude on her husband too. Number 14, tighten up every seemingly loose end on her words and actions to avoid Satan from destroying the peace of the home. Number 15, trust her husband's moves with Christ's love. Number 16, triumph over any intimate overcharge from men in the society by opening up to her husband on every side. Number 17, tribulates in character and conduct and quickly making amends. Humbly, if she flops in her interaction with her husband. Number 18, tremendous in attitude before her husband, children, and neighbors. Number 19, teachable by the Holy Spirit through intuition, godly lives of those around her or her husband. Number 20, tenderly with her husband, giving her thumb up for every effort he makes to please her and rewarding him for her improved submission to him always. Finally, at the last transit of the Holy Spirit last week, a transit at the airport calls the congenial law abiding recline for the Christly supernatural. I will take that from Ephesians 5 verse 24c. It reads, so let the wives be to their own husband in everything. So let the wife be to their husband in everything. And then we'll look at that verse critically and understood. Each wife has her husband and she should be subject to her husband with her body and not to other men. With her soul, not to other men. With her spirit, not to other men. With her possessions and not to other men. With her finances and not to other men. With her decisions and not from other men. Or with her decorum and not just to other men. With her faithfulness and not just to other men. With her prayer partnership and not with other men. That husband will be a confidant and not in other men. With her learning and not necessarily from other men. Or with her budgeting, not with other men. With her dressing or comportment and not for other men. With her relating intimately and not for other men. With her traveling and not with other men without the husband's consent or knowledge. With her eating and not with other men. Serving the Almighty God with husband and not for or with other men. Playing closely and not with other men. Evangelizing the word of the Almighty God and not with other men alone. Smiling or cheerfulness and not with other men always. And the Lord spoke to us expressly last week. Today, the Holy Spirit is still on the pilot seat in our trip today. And we have been refreshed together. And you see, it's going to cruise all time high. And this time around, it's going to transit again at 3 airports. I've been looking at the names on the airport. Number one, airport number one, the divine call on an husband to his wife. Airport number two, the divine commitment of an husband to his wife. Airport number three, the divine cleansing of an husband to his wife. And these three airports will be translated today as we consider the word of God from Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25 and verse 26. In verse 25, Ephesians 5, 25, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. And Ephesians 5, verse 26, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. We'll be looking at learning and leaning on the leader's life today, part 22 in this story, 83 of the book of Ephesians. Ephesians 5, verse 25, it reads, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. In verse 26, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of the water by the word. If you look at these verses now, we'll be going right away as we make our first transit at airport number one, the divine call on an husband to his wife. The divine call on an husband to his wife. I look at Ephesians 5, verse 25a and b. Husbands, love your wives. Husbands, love your wife. A lot of people with demonic interpretation of this word of God will say, can't you see, husband, love your wives? Perhaps the Bible is talking about husbands having many wives. But you understand that when a husband was pluralized, wife was also pluralized. Husbands, love your wives. It's not talking about men with many wives. It's not talking about a man with many wives. It's not talking about a woman with many husbands. It's talking about an husband and a wife. It's talking about one husband and one wife. That's what the Bible is talking about. Because it's talking about Jesus Christ and the church. It's not talking about Jesus Christ and the churches, the church, the invisible church, the assemblage of the born-again souls, the husbands and the wife, and the husband and the wife. It says, husbands, love your wives. Husbands. Emphasis. It was a call of divinity, a call from the Almighty God. That's why it was tagged in this airport, the divine call on a husband to his wife. Husbands. Because if you look at that word there, husband or husbands, if you look at it, well, who then is a husband? That's what we're looking at here there. Because look at that verse again, husbands. In Ephesians 5, verse 25a, husbands, what does the Holy Spirit minister to us by that word? Husbands, Ephesians 5, verse 25. Because if you look at that verse, this part of that verse closely. Husbands, Ephesians 5, verse 25a. Who then is an husband? Number one, a masculine. Who has exceeded the natural level of masculinity. It's not just a male, but a male with an extra embodiment. Which means, it's not just a male or a man. It's an husband. He has gone beyond being a male. He has exceeded the natural level of masculinity. It's not just a male, but a male with an extra embodiment. Because right now he's attached to someone. Who then is an husband? Point number two. A masculine, a partnership with the Creator. In the business of procreation. In the business of purity. And in the business of preservation. Because this is a man. It's not just a male. This man has exceeded that level of masculinity. And this man is a partnership with the Almighty God. And he has this target. It's cumbersome with the target of procreation. It's cumbersome with the target of purity, of preservation, of protection of a specific feminine gender. And the point number three, who then is an husband? Is a masculine with spiritual loads of serving in the capacity of the Almighty God on earth, in the socio-economic and social-spiritual drives on earth. This man is not just a man. This man has spiritual loads of serving in the capacity of the Almighty God. As a matter of fact, he's a representative of Almighty God. In the issue of socio-economic demands, yes, the man should be there. In the issue of social-spiritual balance, the man should be there. Who then is an husband? Point number four, a masculine who listens to the Almighty God for the progression of the family union. Now, who then is an husband? It's a male. But this male is special. He listens to the Creator for the progression of the family union. God speaks to him. Look at it. The husbands, love your wives. That is the masculine. And point number five, a masculine who takes the love of the Almighty God to his specific feminine gender in matrimonial union. He takes the love of God because God loves women. God loves every creature. God loves wives. God loves husband. Loves everybody. He takes that love of God from God's heart, and then he expresses it to the woman that he created. And the point number six, in masculine, who by nature of his calling has become selfless for his wife's pleasing. This is not just a man. It's a selfless man. That is not selfless because of his nature of his calling. He's selfless for his wife's pleasing. And then point number seven, who then is an husband? It's a masculine who has been authorized to call the shot in his matrimonial union with heavenly backing. He has been authorized. He has the power of God, the plenipotentiary. He has the virtue power. This man called the shot in the matrimonial home. He says what happens. He decides what happened. He called the shot with heavenly backing. And point number 10, who then is the husband? Is the essential part of the first category of man with natural powers to fully represent the interest of the Almighty God in his wife's life. Now, this masculine, who then is an husband? This masculine, as you see, is the essential part. He is the essential part of the man. What are we talking about here? Yes, the male Adam was formed. It's the first category of man. In other words, if we are to translate man, if we are to transmute man, of course man remains man. The first category, the first essential part of this man is the husband, because it represents the interest of the Almighty God in his wife's life. Who then is an husband? Point number nine, a masculine whose operation may not be in the physical realm, but spiritual, as his place over others to direct them in the affairs of God's kingdom on earth. Now, who there's an husband? It may not be a physical person, a physical man. In other words, it may not just be a union like that, that we see a man and a woman calls on a wife. It could take the form, it could take the shape of the husband. It could take that form because in his operation, he acts in the capacity of the Almighty God for the people that are under him. That who then is an husband is a masculine whose operation may not be in the physical realm, but spiritual, as his place over others to direct them in the affairs of God in God's kingdom. Point number 10, who then is an husband? A masculine who possesses the innate ability to give directives in loving fashion. This man called the husband, not this man called an husband. He has this innate power. He has this innate ability. He has this propensity that to give directives in loving fashion. Who then is an husband? Point number 11. A masculine who is inclined to busy schedules and may likely ignore the mind of the Almighty God for his wife. So he needs the reminder with a loud call from heaven to love his wife. The husband could be very busy. He's a man that was very busy. And so because he's very busy for the Almighty God, because he's very busy with this and busy with that, he needs to be reminded to love his wife. That's what the Bible says in Ephesians 5, verse 25a. Husbands, love thy wife. Husbands, love your wives. And then you see point number 12 here. Who then is an husband? A masculine who is therefore not made to be lousy or lazy, as this could reduce him to a heap of waste. Which means this man is not lousy. Who then is an husband? It's not a lousy man. It's not a lazy man. Because it's a business-like man. It's business in the things of God, the affairs of God, in the socio-economic world. It's a business-like person. Because if it's lousy and lazy, it could be reduced to a heap of waste. Who then is an husband? Point number 13. A masculine possessing the ability to act to alter trends. Number one. Number two. React to realign trends. Number three. To reorientate other people or to God's interests at home, community, and society. Wonderful. Who then is an husband? Point number 14. A masculine with a divine power to recreate in innovative process. Create an inventive process. And number three, rebrand for massive acceptability. You see this masculine person? This husband. Number one, he has a divine power. Number one, to recreate an innovative process. Number two, to create an inventive process. Number three, to rebrand for massive acceptability. And then who then is an husband? Point number 15. A masculine with a mandate to orchestrate God's interest whenever he finds himself. Who then is an husband? Point number 16. A masculine possessing a physical and spiritual maturity. He can understand the mind of the Almighty God concerning his home, community, and society. He is of age to understand the needs of his wives. You'll see all these points, 16 points now. You see the definitions of who an husband is. If you look at all these 16 definitions now, you understand that who this husband is must be very special. Whoever you are, if you're an husband, you're a special person. The expectation of the Almighty God from an husband. Look at Ephesians 5, verse 25b. Love your wives. You've seen the 16 definitions of an husband. And that is just his instruction. It says, love your wife. It's a clarion call for the Almighty God. An husband should love their wives. And husband should love his wife. And husband should love their wives. But if we say that we have to discuss love now, how would the husband love their wives? Critically, let's look at what love is. Because if we understand what love is, they will understand how to apply it to their wives. Number one, what is love? Let's just take a kind of vertical dissection of the word love. L stands for living. An husband is expected to live for his wife. He's a leading figure with considerable leniency. He's a divine legacy. One who has received a legacy to direct his home. Number two, O stands for open-hearted. An husband ceases to be one if he's not open-minded to his wife. He ceases to be one. And then he's optimized in operation, especially when supported by his wife. And the V stands for visionary. An husband is blessed with visions for his home, community, and society. In his visionary, his vigilance. In his visionary, his words and plans and proposals can be validated by his wife. He's a virtuous soul. He's a virtuous soul of his home, community, and society. And number letter E stands for easygoing. An husband is easy to talk to and easy to understand. He's elated by his wife, energizing to encouraging his wife, and enduring with his wife. Have a look at that now quickly. Let's look at love in family setting, part one. How does an husband love his wife? How does an husband love his wife? This is very critical that we need to understand this. How a husband should love his wife, as instructed by the scripture. Point number one, transparent to his wife. Two, approachable by his wife. Three, respectful to his wife. Four, admiring his wife, irrespective of body changes. Number five, adoring his wife, undermining certain drift in mannerism, which can be resolved expeditiously. Number six, intimate with his wife, ignoring tight schedules. Then number seven, taking his wife along his activities. Number eight, leading his wife in the way of the Almighty God. Number nine, interceding for his wife always. Number ten, interrupting and intercepting any move of satanic agents on his wife. Number 11, regularly prodding and seeking mutual biblical counsel with each other. Number 12, proactively guiding his wife through in-laws, incursions, abridging and sustaining understanding between her and house and his own family. This also applies to his wife's family and his own. And number 13, protecting his wife from any immoral acquaintance, from wrecking havoc in his home. Number 14, staying with her in sickness, staying with her in pains and deliveries and doldrums. Number 15, understanding and incorporating her ideas into his plans upon fair deliberations. Number 16, deliberate in certain circumstances by allowing his wife take decisions for their home. Success of such decisions should be celebrated. Failure should not lead to casting aspersions or blame. On second thought, a unified approach would then be necessary. Understanding not all decisions taken by an husband may be success bound. Number 18, allowing his wife to counsel him when the need arises without any recourse to any external influence. Number 19, making commendable comments when she attempts to impress him. Number 20, spending more time with her than his friends. Now, if you look at all of this now, how an husband should love his wives. You see, the Lord is taking us this far. The Lord is gracious. And the Lord intends that he will repair homes, bless home, or fleet homes. Let's take the transit now. So cruise through the air, cruise into the spiritual world, and cruise in this spiritual world. And even though we are still in the physical terrain, or look at the transit airport number two, the divine commitment of an husband to his wife. The divine commitment of an husband to his wife. In Ephesians 5 verse 25, see, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Christ loved the church and he gave himself for it. And the cue is pivoted on the degree of frequency with which our Lord Jesus Christ loved the church. Because you look at it there, how would the husband love the wife? He said he should do it this way, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. That leads us to the pattern of an husband's love for his wife. How should the husband love his wife? It should be patterned according to the love of Christ for the church. That's what the Bible is saying here. Pattern number one, sacrificing. Your husband should be sacrificing. He's ready to let go his last round of resources to please his wife. Number two, sweetness. He does love his wife with rapid response. Number three, stunning. His love responsive with his wife's view in his subconscious mind. Number four, steadiness. He loves his wife in consistent manner, not disparaging, not letting it go low. Number five, supernaturality. He loves his wife with his heart of supernatural pleasing. He's looking beyond the weakness and looking up to heaven's interventions and pleasing. This provides the needed spiritual strength to carry on. This is the pattern that the wife should go. A pattern of a supersonic. He loves his wife with higher and increasing interest to do so. He loves his wife above his best friend. He loves his wife aside anything apart from the Almighty God. He loves his wife. He loves his wife. And then you look at another pattern there. You see another pattern. Then number seven, sweetness. He loves his wife sweetly, and the sweetness must be expressible. Number eight, spirited. His love for his wife should be lively to bestow a responsive love from her. Number nine, sweeping. When he expresses his love for his wife, it should be overwhelming. It should not sound like a heavy or retarded thing. And then number 10, spontaneity. An husband's love for his wife should be natural and a thing of the heart, the whole person. It should be telepathic in nature. It is not a deliberation, but an art of natural reaction. And number 11, it should be straightforward. Straightforwardness is also a pattern of the husband's love for his wife. An husband's love for his wife should enjoy linear blessings. The love can be predicted, it can be promoted, and it can be progressive. And can be progressive. And then you look at the other pattern over there. We look at pattern number 12, soothing. An husband's love for his wife should bring about improvement on his wife's aches and trying times. His love should provide answers to mind-boggling questions. Number 13, the husband's love should be scientific. His love should be innovative. It should be encompassing, not make her lack behind. Then it should be a sign. Now, you see, his love must be a guide to her joy and performance at home, community, and society. And the pattern number 15, seamless. His love for his wife should not have any undertones. It must be pure for the attention of a godly home. That leads us to the second green. But sanctify the Lord in your heart. I'm ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. 1 Peter 3, verse 15. And the Lord has helped us thus far as we transit at airport number 3, the divine cleansing of an husband for his wife. In Ephesians 5 verse 26, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. That you see this here, the Lord Jesus Christ sanctifies the church. The Lord Jesus Christ cleanses the church by the washing of the water by the word. Your husband should sanctify his wife. Your husband should cleanse his wife by his lifestyle. Now, if you look at that now, if you just oppose our Lord Jesus Christ and the church, and just oppose the husband and the wife, we should understand something here, that it should be of note that any husband cannot provide the satisfying leave to his wife if he's not sanctified himself. No husband can help his wife attain cleansing if he has not been cleansed himself. And then you also understand that the art of trying to give what is not available is an effort in futility. It becomes necessary for every husband to get sanctified and washed in the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ before helping his wife through. Now let's look at the evidences of lack of sanctity and uncleanness in an husband. How do we know that this husband is not clean? How do we know this husband has not sanctified himself? How do we know if this husband has not been cleansed? Because if he's not sanctified, if he's not cleansed, he can't be of help to the wife. He can't sanctify or cleanse the wife. Number one, lust for other women or girls. If this husband, this man called husband, has lust in his heart for other women, other women like the wife, then there's a problem. This husband is not sanctified. It's not fit enough to cleanse or sanctify his own wife. The point number two, thinking of other women or girls when in matrimonial bed with his wife. If this husband is always thinking about other women when with his wife in the bed, he's thinking about all the patches of all the pictures of other women coming up to his mind when with his wife on the bed, it means this husband is not sanctified and he can't sanctify his own wife. Point number three, calling other women's or girls' names when speaking to his wife in such amorous, inadvertent manner. Suddenly, a burst of other people's name. Maybe the husband's, your wife's name is Jane. And instead of calling Jane, he's calling Angelina. He said, Jeline, I'm talking to you. Oh, sorry, I'm talking to Jane. Why? Why should I be in such an amorous manner? That's evil before the Lord. And then maybe she's talking to you, and then you're looking at her, and she's not even aware that as though somebody else, that your husband is lusting after is talking. And that's evil before the Lord. It means this, that's an infinite, but I'm sanctified, I'm clean husband. And point number four, keeping text messages and phone calls away from his wife for so-called privacy rights. Yes, we have privacy rights. We have rights to our privacy, but there should not be any right called privacy when it comes to matrimony. Your wife should have access to her husband's text messages, or have access to her husband's phone calls. If the man keep text messages and phone calls away from his wife, it means that this man is unsanctified, and this man is not fit to sanctify his own wife. And point number five, keeping bank accounts and statements from his wife to meet worldly counsels. In a word, the word will say, you don't tell her everything, just keep this one secretly, just do that secretly, and you keep all the accounts, keep all the statements away from her on purpose. That shows that the man is unsanctified, and he can't sanctify or cleanse his wife. Point number six, imagining the backsides of other women, or gets unconsciously seen around when with his wife. You're looking at the backside of your wife, and you're thinking of the backside of another person. That means that there's a problem there. It means that the man is marrying two wives at the same time. And the point number seven, making undue comparisons of his wife's looks to other women he has seen around. You're looking at the wife like this, and he's making undue comparison. It's not saying, oh, you people are the feminine gender, but it's looking at the eyelashes, trying to compare with somebody he's lusting after. He's looking at her lips, trying to compare with somebody he's lusting after. He's looking at the shape of the head, trying to compare with somebody he's lusting after. Looking at the shape of the legs, trying to compare with somebody he's lusting after. It shows that the man is not sanctified. And the point number eight, hidden interest to be in the company of other women or girls, in preference to his wife. Yes, it's locking in the crevices of his heart. His time with his wife is irritating. His time with his wife is disgusting. He wants to be in the company of other women. And when he's talking to other women, maybe the place of work, maybe wherever he is, maybe in the high station, wherever the person might be, or maybe the society or the community, he will lose himself, will open his mouth and smile and be so welcome and nice. But whenever he is with his wife, he will keep his stone cold face. So that's evil before the Lord. And point number nine, excitement to communicate with other feminine gender than his wife. He's excited when he's communicating with other people. But he's not excited when he's talking to his wife. It shows that this man is not sanctified. This man is not clean enough to be able to sanctify his own wife. And then point number 10, frequent low libido. When with his wife, he yet falls to the edge by men speaking with other feminine gender in open environment. It's with his wife. The sexual instinct is not there. The sexual drive or desire is not there. It's totally low libido. But whenever he's talking to other people, even the open space, he falls to the edge. He pees on his body without anything happening. And he roughens himself. He stares himself off to something evil. And that's evil before the Lord. It means that this man is unsanctified. This man is unclean to even sanctify his own wife. And point number 11, narrates his wife's weaknesses to his own family. Wives, family or friends. He tells his family about the wife's weaknesses. When he sees his wife's sisters, he will open up about his own wife's weaknesses. If he sees his friends like this, he will tell them everything about his wife, about the weaknesses, as if other people don't have their own weaknesses. That shows that this man is unsanctified. In point number 12, when her food irritates him, but very quick to accept the restaurant's offers. He hates the wife's food, but when he gets to buy food in the eateries, he's very, very excited. And point number 13, when his wife can no longer have access to him when he's undressed. Whenever he's undressed, he keeps shouting, I'm dressing up, don't come in. Oh, what is that? Your body is our bodies. Our bodies is your body. So what is the issue about the privacy for? And point number 14, when he becomes sour to return home after a hectic outing, because his wife's presence no longer attracts him, but pretends that all is well, is done with the day, and it's coming home now. He wants to stay back. He wants to stay back with his friends, to get himself drunk, to eat all he can, talk and chat with people, and comes home very late in the night, because the presence of the wife no longer attracts him. That means this man is unsanctified. And point number 15, when there's no more mention of his wife's name during private praying, he prays all alone. He does everything, and when he prays. He pray for people, pray for the pastor, pray for the members, but he won't mention his wife's name in the prayer. He won't talk to God about his wife in his prayer. It shows that this man is unsanctified. He's not clean enough to be able to sanctify his wife. How can an husband sanctify himself and become blood washed in the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? It is simple. Every sinful husband will call upon the name of the Lord now. and ask God for mercy. Every sinner too will call upon the name of the Lord and have before mercy. But before then, they should understand the Revelation 21 verse 8. But the fearful and the unbelieving, and the abominable, and the murderers, and the warmongers, and sorcerers, and idolaters, and liars, I shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Do not forget that. In Revelation 20 verse 11, and I saw a great white throne, and he that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. In Revelation 20 verse 12, and I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, according to their works. In Revelation 20 verse 13, and the sick gave up the dead, which were in it, and the death and hell delivered of the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every man according to his works. In Revelation 20 verse 14, and the death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. In Revelation 20 verse 15, and whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Wherever you are right now, if only you can open up your hand and say, Lord, I've been a dirty husband. I've been a naughty husband. I've been an unrighteous husband. I've been an unholy husband. I want to come to the Lord. Now, select your national point number one. Husbands, love your wives. Ephesians 5 verse 25a and b. It is compulsory for every husband to love his wife. Select your national point number two. Even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Ephesians 5, the 25c, every husband must be self-sacrificing for his wife. So also point number three, that he must sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. Ephesians 5, verse 26, every husband must lead by example in holiness and righteousness for his wife to follow. Also point number four, every husband must seek responsibility to God's representative in his home. So Session point number five, every husband must love his wife superbly above friends and family. Question: are you a loving husband or a hateful husband? Be the former please, it pays to become. The Lord has spoken to us now. He has transited at the last airport, and we need to alight the flight. Before we alight this flight, I need you to open your mouth now and begin to pray. Ask the Lord for mercy. Ask him for grace upon your life. Asking for grace upon your soul. Lord, I can't do this alone. Lord, I need your strength and grace to be the husband that you want me to be to my wife. Open your mouth now, pray. All the areas you have defected, all the areas you have defaulted, all the areas you have done wrong to your wife, ask the Lord for mercy to make amends. Tell her sorry. Make amends and do the right. From now henceforth, start doing the right thing. And the Lord will touch you. The Lord will give you the empowerment right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Open your mouth now, pray. The Lord is listening to you now. Ask him to have mercy upon your soul. He will surely have mercy upon you. Not just husbands, not just wives. Anybody listening to the sound of my voice, if you have not heard Jesus, explain Jesus in your heart. It is needful for you to call upon him for salvation now. Ask him to have mercy upon your soul. He will surely have mercy upon you. He will surely forgive you your sins. He will do so right now in the mighty name of Jesus. You say after me, Father Lord, I come before you. Oh Lord, I've been living below expectation as an husband. I pray for now and spot, Lord, according to your word that you have taught me today. Lord, I pray I will leave the expectation in Jesus' name. The power to do so give unto me, Lord. And the grace to do so give unto me, Lord. I never knew of the reproof repetitive in my home. I pray, Lord, I will sanctify my wife by your word, because I will live by your word. I will wash my wife by your word, because I will be washed by your word. Lord, I pray that you sanctify me and wash me first, so that, Lord, I can sanctify my wife too by my lifestyle. Lord, I pray, do this for me now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, because I know that you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. If you have prayed that prayer with me right now, it is done. Father, in the name of Jesus, I come before you. I pray, Lord, any husband that prays such prayer, I pray that the power that will make them real husbands, you'll give unto your people. Lord, you'll give them in Jesus' name, insightful husband, inspirational husband. You'll make them, oh God, become in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, they'll bestow their wives. They'll be your voice. They'll call the shots. They'll counsel. They will lead. Oh Lord, I pray to be so in Jesus' name. And the wives will see them in living. You'll see them like Christ. You'll see them like God in your home. I pray, Lord, the power will give unto them in Jesus' name. Oh, pray, Lord, every lazy, lousy husband, you take off throw away. I pray, Lord, that you energize them because they're the energy that the wives need. I pray, Lord, that you will listen to their wives more than their friends in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray that you won't sell out their wives to their families, to their own, to the wives' families, or to their friends, or to any acquaintances. Oh, Lord, I pray they will interrupt, they will intercept any evil person that wants to interject into the home. I pray, Lord, you give them strength and insightfulness to do so in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, because I know that you have answered. Touch homes today. Repair homes today that will have loving wives, will have loving husband, and will have beautiful homes across the world. I know, Lord, that this is done. This is the bedrock of a solid society. And this is done. This is the bedrock of a solid community. And this is done. This will be the bedrock. This, of course, is the bedrock of a solid nation, solid nations, and solid world. I pray, O Lord, mighty God, that this word will swish into the people, will get to the people, will be strewed unto the people, unhindered in Jesus' name. Every evil force that the devil has set up to hinder this word from reaching out to hearts, I counsel in the name of Jesus. I decree that it will get to people, expressly, and they will have change of lives in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, because I know it is done. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. God bless you.